What is up, everyone? This is Totally Random, back here with another video. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button and join my channel and make sure to hit the bell for notifications. But anyway, guys, all right, so a lot of you have already talked about this on Twitter. I've seen people tweeting about it and, you know, telling me about it too. But, all right, there was a Screen Rant article. It's called Justice League, Every Confirmed Change to Zack Snyder's Vision. And so we're just going to read over it, you know, and give my opinion on it, whatever. It's actually, I've read it a couple times. It's actually a decent article, but, yeah, and every time you see the changes that were made, you just feel like punching through a screen, though. But all right, let's get started with it. All right, so starts out with saying, when Zack Snyder left the production of Justice League, everyone close to production claimed Joss Whedon was merely completing the film Snyder started. But it turns out the movie saw significant changes in reshoots, overhauling the movie's story and appearance. While many of these changes were readily apparent in the movie itself, which has been dubbed a Frankenstein project. I mean, it was more than just a Frankenstein project. It was a complete colossal failure of just, we just need to lighten everything up and forget everything else, you know? Forget continuity. Just everything needs to be lightened up. Everything needs to be brighter, more jokishly, no seriousness. Okay, but a number of leaks and other reveals in the year since have revealed that the changes were even more significant. Like, completely changed the film. It was not even a Zack Snyder movie. A conservative estimate says 30 minutes of Justice League's theatrical cut is a product of Whedon's reshoots. That's very conservative, because I think someone saw somewhere broke down the film, and he said pretty much a little over half the movie was actually Joss Whedon. It was not Zack Snyder's. It was just a few shots here and there that were Zack Snyder's, but overall, majority of it was Joss Whedon. And assuming a rumored runtime of 3 hours for Zack Snyder's original cut, that means over an hour and a half of Snyder's original movie is entirely missing. Probably 2 hours, actually. And even more was tweaked and altered to a new context. That's so true. They take, you know, a shot here and there, you know? The end of the movie where you see, in the theatrical cut, you see Aquaman say, "All right," you know, he says, "All right." That shot wasn't even in that part of that movie. In the Snyder's, it was at the part where they're in the sewers under there where he says that. So you can see they take shots here and there and just mix them up. It shouldn't be a surprise fans are calling for a Snyder cut of the movie. Yep, because we deserve justice. There's been much debate over whether or not a Snyder cut exists, but Snyder completed 100% of principal photography. That's key. 100% of principal photography. Snyder completed it. There is no doubt in my mind. He finished it and everything. I'm pretty sure it's even done by now, as I said before. Before he left, and storyboard artist Jay Oliva and cyborg actor Ray Fisher both say he got all the footage he needed for a complete cut, meaning the question of the Snyder Cut's level of completion is dependent on how far into post-production he was. And people still question that. A guy who worked on the film, an actor who was a main person in the film, says he got everything done. He got everything he needed. He shot everything. You know, Jay Oliva said that. People are like, "No, it doesn't exist." Why? Because a blogger said it doesn't exist. It's like, you know, these idiots don't know. Regardless, Warner Bros. Currently has no plans to release the movie. No, we do not know that. You are all running off of that Wall Street Journal article, which said a unnamed source, an unnamed executive said they have no plans. It's not even true. It's so dumb. They keep running off that. Guys, they have no plans to release it only if we give up on the movement, okay? That's the only reason why. So don't give up on the movement. So fans could have to wait a few years for the Snyder Cut to finally be completed. It's completed. Just shut up about that. Okay, I'm just going to skip this whole little section. All right, in the meantime, here's all the confirmed changes to the movies. Numerous minor tweaks, snips, dialogue inserts, and other little changes have been made, and countless more have been speculated or rumored, so it'll be almost impossible to chronicle every single tiny difference. The focus will be on the more significant changes, revealing what Zack Snyder's Justice League was supposed to look like, sound like, and be about. Alright, first thing, Junkie XL was replaced by Danny Elfman. The first sign of trouble after Whedon took over Justice League was the departure of the film's original composer, Tom Holkenberg, a.k.a. Junkie XL. After collaborating with Hans Zimmer on Man of Steel and Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, Junkie was all set to take the reins for Justice League. His work is known for bearing a strong electronic influence with heavy drums. Basically, he's very influenced by Hans Zimmer, obviously, as you can tell, because Hans Zimmer uses that a lot in his music. He was replaced by Danny Elfman, who is, I don't have any words right now to say, but whose music is more whimsical and strings. They should put more Cinderella and shitty in every form, because it was just complete, terrible music. We're hearing Cinderella music play while Batman is fighting a parademon. That is not possible. How do you play that music? What in your mind gave you the idea, I'm going to play this music while Batman's fighting a parademon? I'm not even going to play Wonder Woman's theme. I'm going to play a fraction of a weird tuned out different version of it. I'm not even going to play Man of Steel music. I'm just going to completely forget that and play my old Batman music that no one cares about, you know? Freaking play Hans Zimmer's music from the Dark Knight trilogy if you want to play Batman music. Your music sucks compared to Hans Zimmer's music. Don't even compare your music to his. It's nowhere near that level. While Elfman brought back some classic DC themes. Oh, classic. I can't even remember because it was so crappy. DC themes for Batman. He didn't even bring a classic theme for Superman. You were a disgrace to Superman for what you did. You played a fraction of a second of John Williams' little thing, and it was with a weird darkless turn to it, and it didn't even sound like it, and it was for half a second. So don't even say you brought it back. He didn't bring back anything. He brought back Cinderella music, man. His score lacked the gravitas that defined the previous movies in the franchise. Amen. Junkie XL said he planned to record the soundtrack in July, and he was fired in June, so there was likely significant work completed, but it wouldn't have been 100% completed or polished before he left. Okay, that is true. But the point is, he started working on it. And why did the douchebag named Joss Whedon decide, you're fired? What gave him that drive to fire him? He had no reason to fire him. The only thing is, they were probably like, your music's too dark. It's going to give little kids nightmares. They're going to go to bed scared, you know? Like, and that's a dumb reason itself to fire him. I don't know. That's why I said Joss Whedon, all these idiots are all fired, gone. Never will they touch another DC movie ever again. But like I said, I've said before, the music could have made the movie 100 times better. Like, literally, people do not understand how music shapes a movie. It is so, so much influence that comes from the music. You don't understand how Nolan's films are not just awesome because of Nolan. They're awesome because of Hans Zimmer's score. You see the Avengers theme, you know, everyone's roaring in Infinity War when the moment that Thor comes down. But not everyone's going to realize it's because of the music. You hear Alan Silvestri's score and it's just intense moment. Everyone's just like, oh my goodness, this is awesome, you know. Those moments, you hear it in Man of Steel, oh my goodness. You hear it when Superman, you know, he's about to fly. You see it in the end credit scene, you know, before that, you hear the music and you just feel all hopeful and optimistic. You just feel it. And then you see the scenes when they're fighting I can't even remember his name, Zod, and you hear the intensity, you're just like, oh my goodness. You hear it when Batman's fighting Bane and the Joker, you hear it, and you're just like, oh my goodness, this is amazing, you know? People don't understand how much music influences a movie. Alright, Steppenwolf's design was changed from the one in Batman v Superman, oh my goodness. They wanted to make him look like a complete CGI fake idiot. I don't even know what they did to him. We were supposed to get this alien nightmarish look. I don't know why they changed it. Why? Because people were going to piss their pants in the theaters because of how scary it was? Well, you shouldn't be watching movies then if you're going to get scared and go cry to your mom somewhere else, okay? One of the most notable changes happened during pre-production, and that's the overall redesign of Steppenwolf. As many fans have noticed, the version of Steppenwolf glimpsed in the Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice Ultimate Edition is drastically different than the version in Justice League. And it's not drastically, it's because they completely changed it. You can just look in the picture where they show, you know, the concept designs. Does this look like anything like what we got in theaters? No, they completely changed it up. This dude looks like an alien, something out of Star Trek, a horror, a nightmare. That's what I love DC for, because it's not like kiddish. It's like, this is aliens, man. You're fighting freaking badass aliens here. While there's some early previews, pre-visualizations of some scenes with the old Steppenwolf designs. Those aren't actually for use in the film. They're basically digital storyboards to help visualize action scenes in pre-production. The actual VFX made for the end product starts from scratch again. But we could tell that they changed up whatever design that was originally going to be used, okay? That's the point there. There's behind-the-scenes footage from during pre-production where concept art for the new versions can be glimpsed on the wall. The change in design likely happened early enough that it was before the release of Batman v Superman, and it could have been early enough to influence the decision to cut the Steppenwolf scene in that movie. Nah, bro, they cut it down from BVS because Nolan decided he's going to walk away. He didn't want any more, you know, influence. And then all the idiot executives were like, hey, cut it out. We need it down to 2.5 hours. 3 hours is too long, blah, 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 blah. You know? They cut out 30 minutes. It's not, they didn't cut it out because they were thinking, oh, it's going to be too scary. They weren't thinking that far ahead. I know Zack Snyder was, but not these other guys. They were just thinking, no, cut it out a little shorter, you know? The parademons hate the siren and smell fear. One of the first scenes in the movie made a change that also tied through the majority of the movie and was used to streamline the plot, and that's the rooftop scene where Superman captures a parademon. It's one of the worst scenes I've seen in the movie. It was shot by Joss Whedon all the way. Thanks to an interview with the actor that played the thief in that scene, we know it was a Whedon addition, crappy addition, and that means the concept of a siren that attracts the parademons and the fact that they smell fear was also introduced through reshoots. Those concepts should be brought back in the final act, reducing Batman's role to playing that same siren noise to attract the parademons, then also with Steppenwolf attracting the parademons to himself because he felt fear. It's still not known what plot elements were replaced by this. Alright, so this whole dumbness, Zack Snyder doesn't put this dumb, stupid crap in his movies, okay? Joss Whedon does it, and I'm surprised he did. Because from a guy who did the Avengers, you'd expect a little bit more, I don't know, common sense from him. But, you know, fear is the thing now. And then the fact, oh, this scene, Steppenwolf at the very end of the movie when he's like, oh, man, I'm fearing. Like, did you not fear so many more times when Superman was beating the crap out of you? It was like, all of a sudden, now you're feeling fear? It's just so dumb. It was so dumb. It wasn't thought through. This whole thing, it was stupid. It was not a Zack Snyder thing. This whole side plot, bam, was not what's supposed to get in the Snyder Cut. The opening credits were mostly Joss Whedon. Oh my goodness, that was an embarrassment. Zack Snyder is famous for his opening credit scene. While he's controversial on the whole, shut up about him, whatever. Most people agree that his opening credits for Dawn of the Dead and Watchmen are masterworks. Oh my goodness, Watchmen was amazing. That makes it odd that Justice League's opening credits weren't all his design. It's possible some of the footage used in the opening credits is his. Some of it even repurposed from other moments of the movie, but the song Everybody Knows That I'm Stupid and I Don't Know What I'm Doing. Yeah, that song by Sigrid was actually selected by Whedon, as he revealed on Twitter. Yeah, this idiot picked this song. I have no clue why. And it was just like, it's so dumb. It doesn't even fit the movie. And it's like, what are you doing? You're setting the tone for the movie by playing this song. And with these credits, it's just like, what does this have to do? I mean, it's showing sort of like, oh, look how lost and divided we are. Blah, blah. And it's so dumb. My point is, it was just so dumb. How did he put it in the movie? I don't know. That's why Joss Whedon had too much control on this movie. Lex Luthor's role was much bigger. Instead of Batman learning about parademons by catching them and making them explode, he was actually learning from Lex Luthor's journal and possibly from Lex himself. It's not clear how much of Lex was cut, but we know Batman was using his journal because we see it in a couple of scenes, and he also makes a reference to it at one point. The thing is, the journal contains information about the mother boxes Luthor didn't learn about until the end of Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, so it couldn't have been confiscated with the rest of Luthor's possessions. Thanks to concept art, we know Lex was supposed to be in a cell in Arkham with the journal where he was likely recording all the information he was exposed to on the Kryptonian ship when he was connected with Steppenwolf. That means Batman likely paid him a visit to interrogate him and get the journal sometime early in the movie. Luthor's role was reduced to a simple post-credit scene, but his influence was likely far more significant in the first half of the movie. And, like I said before, there's much more to all these characters. But Warner Bros., the executives, Joss Whedon, all decided to de-Snyderize it and just ruin the heck out of it. Alright, this part, you know, punching the screen is, you can go ahead and do that. Superman's story was almost entirely reshot. Yeah, no shit. We saw that. We saw that very clearly from the moment we saw the first scene of Superman in the very first 5 seconds of the movie. We see Superman with his, behold, his beautiful CGI mount, you know? The changes to Superman are hard to pin down because they're most of the most pervasive in the whole movie. They're, you should put just crappiest in the whole movie. And the fact that he wasn't in any marketing means there's no original footage to compare against. There probably is plenty of original footage, they just didn't use it. What is evident, though, is what his Superman reshoots. Because Henry Cavill's mustache for his role in Mission Impossible 6 couldn't be shaved, meaning there's an awkward digital upper lip on all Superman's new scenes. I don't understand how they, like, can you not tell while you're making this, guys, this just doesn't look right. I mean, look, compared to the... without the mustache, does the looks kind of weird. Should we try to animate it better, you know, or, you know, it's like, whoever was doing this should be fired and should never work for Warner Bros. Again. How do you let this debacle get into the screenings, into theaters? How? I don't know. That's why all these idiots should be fired. You can't let this happen. Like, I'm glad it happened because we would, there wouldn't be this criticism for this movie, but how they got in there? I just don't understand. Geoff Johns, I don't know what you were doing. Based on the upper lip changes, it's evident that almost all of Superman was reshot. Reshot. This guy who wrote this article, his English is bad. Reshot, particularly dialogue, aside from a moment or two in the final battle, part of the scene where with Bruce at Kent Farm at the end, and the very last shot of him pulling his shirt open to reveal the Superman symbol in classic fashion. Yeah. That's literally just sums it up there. That was it. That was actually Zack Snyder's, which is barely anything. Everything else was all Josh Whedon's reshoots, which is terrible. 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 I don't understand why they changed this character up. I don't understand. Zack Snyder knew what he was doing, but you guys clearly do not. And it's so frustrating. So frustrating. Alright, Darkseid was in the movie and played an important role. Outside of a vague shout-out by Steppenwolf, Darkseid makes no appearance in the theatrical cut of Justice League, but he was supposed to play a much, much bigger role in the Snyder Cut. It's not clear if these scenes ended up on the cutting room floor, or were removed from the script in earlier stages, or a little bit of both, but Darkseid would have made multiple appearances in Zack Snyder's movie. Golly, man. Reading that whole thing is just frustrating, because we were supposed to get Darkseid. He wasn't supposed to be the main villain. Now some people are complaining about that, saying, oh, I'm glad they didn't, because I didn't want to see Dark Sinus. I wanted to see him in the next one, you know, blah, blah, blah. You're just getting a glimpse of him just the way you see Thanos in all the Avengers movies, okay? And Guardians of the Galaxy. You're just a glimpse of him. You see a little bit of him, and that's it. He's not the main villain. You're going to get him in the next one. The first reference that we know of would have come in a cutscene where Wonder Woman explores a shrine containing murals of an ancient invasion of Earth. On that mural, there's an image of Darkseid leading his parademons along with Greek text describing the events of the battle. Yeah, it was frustrating to read. In the theatrical cut, the battle was led by Steppenwolf, but according to the mural, Darkseid actually led the battle, or Uxus, the younger, pre-Darkseid version of the character, per a comment made by Zack Snyder. In this battle, Darkseid would have faced off against the Greek gods, specifically Ares, in an epic battle before being driven away from the Earth. And that would have been amazing to see Ares fight Steppenwolf, or not Steppenwolf, to fight Darkseid. That would have been a badass scene that would have just been amazingly shot by Zack Snyder and would have just crushed everything. It would have just been amazing. But nope. Joss Whedon and all the douchebags Geoff Johns have to go and change it all up because it's too scary. And they gotta poop their pants if they watch these movies. And they're not supposed to be so dark. God, I hate Joss Whedon. I hate Geoff Johns. Given the prominence of Darkseid earlier in the movie, it's possible he had more interaction with Steppenwolf throughout. But that hasn't been confirmed yet. His last appearance also isn't confirmed, but it's a fairly logical certainty. Steppenwolf's defeat is clearly heavily edited at the end of the movie, and a report before the movie came out said that the ending was being reshot to remove a Darkseid cliffhanger. I heard that. I believe it's somewhat true, but not like cliffhanger in terms of like, oh my goodness, the Justice League almost died, right? They're all dead right now, and it ends like that. No, I think it was just going to end, you know, where Steppenwolf goes up, and then Darkseid's like, you didn't do that for me. You were doing that for yourself because you wanted to defeat me. You're going to kill you. Pfft, like that. That sort of ending. But while on Earth, The Justice League, all happy, they defeated Steppenwolf, go on to the next day. That's not really a cliffhanger, but obviously the executives were like, it's too dark, the critics and bloggers all said, too dark, it's too dark. When presented with a missing behind-the-scenes shot from this moment, Snyder said the League was looking at a boom tube. It was likely more than just boom tube, and this is where Darkseid revealed himself to the League. 100% sure, or maybe, I don't know actually. Cyborg's origins and backstory were cut. Before Justice League's release, Zack Snyder said Cyborg was supposed to be the heart of the movie. Yep, he was supposed to be the heart of the movie. We all, they completely butchered his character. So it wasn't surprising to fans when Cyborg got surprisingly little setup and may have suffered from some of the most significant changes outside of Superman. A number of deleted scenes show him discovering his powers, learning about his ability to fly, tap into computer networks, deploy weapons, and more. Another deleted scene shows Cyborg learning the history of the Mother Boxes, including their apparent discovery by Nazis and more. Since he's born of a Mother Box, this isn't just the box's history, but his as well. A storyboard from the scene shows that it follows the Mother Box up until it transforms Victor Stone into Cyborg, showing an alternate version of his origins from the lab cam feed in Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice in a scene that is likely resembled Dr. Manhattan's transformation in Watchmen. And I don't even want to go into details because I'm already going lengthy with this video, but, like, why? I mean, obviously, they wanted, why would you change his character? Why can't we see any backstory? Obviously because of that 2-hour mandate, but like, you know, people are going to criticize it when a character's not built up. You made so many movies, Warner Bros., yet you don't realize, hey man, when characters aren't built up, they're going to get criticism because they're just, there's no proper development in that character. It's like obvious, but you know, Ray Fisher was supposed to have more time as Victor Stone, with the scene of him playing football leading into a car accident that kills his mom and severely injures him before we see a new perspective of his birth as Cyborg. All of this was condensed down into a theatrical cut apartment scene with Silo Stone, with brief exposition establishing the high points of his backstory, blah blah blah. More just hashtag release Snyder Cut. Flash's backstory in Iris West. Another leaked, deleted scene would have shown Barry Allen zipping out of a cornerstone to save Iris West from her near death in a car accident. Iris West ended up being entirely removed from the movie, so it's not known if she played a significant role outside the scene, or if it was just a flashback about Barry learning his powers, but it was definitely more backstory than what ended up in the final film. And it's just, as I said before, Warner Bros. Has no clue what they're doing. They just hear the words Brighton and no darkness and all happiness, because that's what makes movies awesome, when people smile. Aquaman backstory and Atlantis lore. This has pissed me off a lot because, you know, I'm a big fan of Aquaman and I wanted to see everything with this character backstory, Volko, you know, with Mara, but lo and behold, I can't even explain what happened anymore. Aquaman also saw a significant bit of his backstory cut. The reshoots made major altercations to the, I can't even pronounce that, Dupivik Iceland scene, including a likely appearance from Mara. Zack Snyder posted images of Amber Heard in full Mara costume from Iceland, but due to lack of context, it's hard to know what role she played in that part of the film, since the theatrical cut bears no trace of her presence. Blockbuster costume hair and makeup departments don't just get someone in character for fun, though, and Amber Heard had no business being in Iceland otherwise. Willem Dafoe's Volko also shot scenes for Justice League, but was entirely removed. Nothing is known about the nature of his scenes, though. Obviously, you should probably all go tweet it out or go just ask Willem Dafoe what happened, you know, in the Snyder Cut. What happened in Justice League? When it comes to Atlantis, Justice League was never going to reveal Atlantis itself. Yeah, we knew that, because Zack Snyder told us about that. Since Zack Snyder was leaving that to James Wan's Aquaman solo movie, but there was way more Atlantean lore to the original cut. I hats off to Zack Snyder for not showing it, because the first shot when we watch Aquaman, by the way, is going to be Zack Snyder's shot. Because that's what James Wan said. It's Zack Snyder's shot, the first shot of Atlantis. But, hats off to Zack Snyder for saying, yo, that's your movie, you do it. I totally understand. As shown in VFX test posted by Zack Snyder before he left the project, Aquaman approached the Dead King's throne, but the scene was altered for the theatrical cut, so a dead Atlantean soldier is floating in front of where the Dead King was before. Since Aquaman has his armor and Quindet when he joins up with the Justice League, he presumably was going to Atlantis to get those, knowing he encountered Mera back in Iceland. His pit stop in Atlantis may have been related to whatever they talked about there. This part ticks me off a lot because I've, as I said before, Aquaman's one of my favorite characters, and I want to see more of him. More the better, you know. Seeing just a tidbit, seeing Vulko, you know, seeing a little bit more of Mera, seeing just a little bit, like, mentioning Queen Atlanta, you know, Arthur's mom, seeing just a little bit backstory to these characters. That's the thing. You can't build up a movie with no backstory. People will criticize it. Warner Bros. Obviously didn't understand that, and I don't know when they'll understand that. It's so frustrating. All right, so the whole league was at Clark Kent's grave. All right. The theatrical cut doesn't dedicate much time to the retrieval of Superman's body, other than a brief scene with Flash and Cyborg actually digging up his grave, but according to a photo released by Snyder, the whole team was supposed to be there. Considering Kansas is halfway across the country from Metropolis and Gotham, this whole moment in the movie was likely more significant. As it is, Cyborg and Flash basically teleport to Clark's grave for a brief scene, then basically teleport back with the body. Adding the rest of the league to the scene means there's definitely more missing from this action. Obviously, it was another stupidity. Like, what? I don't understand why they cut this out. Was it too dark to see Aquaman there with his hands in his pocket and Gal Gadot just standing there with Flash and Cyber? I mean, I don't know. It's just more just... I just don't get it. Why? Like, it's so dumb. You just cut it out. Anyway, all right. Justice League originally continued Batman v Superman's Nightmare plot. That is super important and just continuity, guys. Continuity. Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, including the infamous nightmare scene where Batman is seen leading a resistance in an apocalyptic future ruled by Darkseid to acquire kryptonite before he's attacked and captured by parademons and killed by Superman. Bruce Wayne jolts awake in the Batcave at the end, only to be greeted by the Flash, breaking through the time and space to deliver a cryptic message. Obviously, that's the thing, warning him that he's right about Lois and don't trust him and all that. But I love the Nightmare timeline. I absolutely loved it. One of the reasons why I love the DCEU. It shouldn't surprise anyone to know that wasn't the end of Snyder's plan for the Nightmare. His originally intended 5-movie arc likely would have been littered with similar scenes leading up to some grand culmination in the end. Justice League ultimately had no connection to the nightmare scene from Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, but thanks to deleted storyboard, we know what it would have been, what it would have featured. This new nightmare scene would have started after Cyborg plugged into the Kryptonian ship before showing the rubble of the Hall of Justice, before the camera panned to show the same Omega symbol in Gotham Harbor from the last nightmare scene. Darkseid appears in the storyboard, and he appears to use the mother boxes to form the Unity and terraform the planet. And I don't understand, you know, the reason why probably they cut this out because it was too dark and they were all going to be like, oh, I'm going to cry, I want my mommy, you know, because it's all too dark, you know, everything's so dark. Superman needs to smile more. It's just stupid. It's just all stupid. All right, Lois and Martha's side story was replaced. Lois and Martha both had a really small role in the theatrical cut of Justice League after being major players in both Man of Steel and Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, which is understandable because of all the new characters, but the footage of them that ended up in the theatrical cut was mostly Joss Whedon reshoots. While the Joss Whedon scene was mostly the two characters talking about Clark, with the TV news making an alien probing joke, and Martha making the thirsty joke, we still don't know what was being reshot. Snyder released an image of Lois and Martha in Lois's Metropolis apartment, but without context, their original story is still entirely unknown. Yeah, we get that famous, thirsty, stupid joke that no one freaking needed or wanted to see. I did not want to see that in the movie whatsoever, but lo and behold, the feminist Joss Whedon has to put this scene in there. It's another cringy scene. All right. Clark and Lois's Kent Farm reunion was reshot. We pretty much know that. One of the weirder major changes was a major moment highlighted in one of the last trailers. Lois and Clark in the cornfield on the Kent Farm. While a similar scene was in the final movie, it was almost entirely reshot. Cutting out the version of the scene from the trailers, It doesn't even make sense why they reshot it. I don't understand. They even zoom. It's like they like, we want to show you how crappy this movie is, so we're going to purposely zoom even in on Superman's face. We're going to show you Clark's full CGI upper lip. The new version of the scene most notably removes all connections to Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice by cutting the reference to Lois's engagement ring, which Clark died before he could give her. It doesn't make any sense why they reshot the scene. They're so stupid. It's so dumb. It's like upper lip CGI. Greater than any connection to the previous film. It's like they chose the part where they said, where Lois asked, this is the most Josh Whedon line ever, where Lois asks Clark, what does death feels like? And then he's like, itchy. And it's like, oh my goodness, that's the most Josh Whedon thing to say, because Zack Snyder would never put that in his movie. It's so dumb. It's just for comedic relief. It's a takeaway from any seriousness in the moment. And it was stupid. I don't even know why they reshot it. That's the thing. Like, why did they reshoot it? What Clark and they originally had with what Zack shot? Was that just too dark? Too dark to see these guys reconnecting? It was too dark? I mean, I don't know. These guys are stupid. That's what I'm saying. These Warner Bros. Executives, Jeff Johns, Joss Whedon, all these guys are just stupid and don't know what they're doing. All right. They tried to make the Wayne Aerospace Hangar look like the Batcave. One of the messiest alterations was the decision to recontextualize the Wayne Aerospace Hangar as a part of the Batcave. This is done through an established shot from over Bruce Wayne's lakeside house and the lake over the Batcave, before cutting to a scene in the hangar or the addition of the CGI bats flying overhead at one point. But even without the original context, it's clear the building is not underground. Not only is it way bigger than the rest of the Batcave, but also there's high windows with bright light clearly streaming in. More stupidity. More, I don't know. Oh, wait, what? Oh, just the moment's like, oh, crap. How did that? Oh, wait, too late. Can't do it. Movie's about to come out. You know, stupidity from Warner Bros. Alfred meets the team. A deleted scene surfaced online depicting Alfred meeting the team for the first time. In the theatrical cut, connective scenes like this are largely glossed over due to a strict 2-hour runtime mandate by Warner Bros., aka Kevin Tsujihara, who has no idea what he's doing. But Alfred meeting the likes of The Flash, Aquaman, and Cyborg is obviously a significant moment that longtime fans would have loved. Yes, we longtime fans would have loved to see Alfred meeting the whole Justice League for the first time, but obviously, well, they got the mandate, the 2-hour runtime, and they're just like, oh, just can't put it in, because it's not important, you know? I mean, meeting the team for the first time is not very important at all. All right, missing scenes of the scene of the League in Star Labs. The League was supposed to spend some time together in Star Labs, except due to the way the theatrical cut is edited, there's no clear place in the plot for it to fit. From the small clips and trailers and behind-the-scenes images, there's a few clues to go by, though particularly by a shot of Cyborg carrying a mother box. This means it almost certainly happened at some point after the formation of the League, but before Superman's resurrection. There is one of the scenarios where the plot was so significantly changed from the original purpose of the Star Labs scene is no longer evident, but it's possibly the League consulted them on bringing Superman back from the dead, or the origin of the parademons. Some of the images even show battle damage and signs of an action scene. So, again, a lot happened in Star Labs that we don't know about yet. That's why we need the Snyder Cut. There's so much, as I said before previously, throughout this whole article anyway, mentioned. That's why we need the Snyder Cut. There's just stuff. They just put it to the cutting floor, changed it up, because I don't know why it was too scary. The critics said, though, we need the less darker. It's pathetic. Jeff Johns has no idea what he's doing. He just wanted reshoot after reshoot after reshoot because he just wanted to change it up because he felt Zack Snyder doesn't show justice to these characters and blah, blah, blah. I know, it's just so stupid. All right, Ryan Choi, a.k.a. The Atom, was cut. One of the things cut from Star Labs was a scientist named Ryan Choi, who fans might remember as the second person to take the mantle of the size-changing superhero, the Atom. Choi would have worked closely with Silas Stone, and his involvement would have been more than a mere cameo, as Snyder confirmed he was supposed to have dialogue. That doesn't mean he had a major role or even suited up as the Atom, though. His part most likely amounted to Jenna Malone's role in Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice Ultimate Edition, also cut from the theatrical version of the film, or Carrie Ferris in Man of Steel and Batman v Superman. This is something, you know, it could have been in the Snyder's cut as a deleted scene or something. But still, as I said before, so stupid. Snyder is thinking ahead of all of us. You see, just teasing the Atom. What's wrong with teasing the Atom? I don't know. Warner Bros. Too dark. Silas Stone originally died. Silas Stone wasn't only supposed to have a bigger role due to more cyborg scenes and more Star Lab scenes, but he was also supposed to be killed off, serving as a major motivation for Cyborg in the rest of the movie. The death scene most likely happened during the cut Star Lab battle scene, which is why there's no clear point where his death was reshot. And people are like, oh, they're so glad they didn't kill him, man. It was important. No, guys, you gotta think logically. This was gonna be an emotional scene for Cyborg, seeing his dad die. You know, he hates his dad because he's mad at his dad. Now, he doesn't hate him. He's mad at him because his dad wasn't there for him. You know, he caused the death of his mom and all this and that. You know, it's an emotional scene. Then him seeing his dad die, it's just like, I'm sorry, you know, it's I'm sorry, you know. And it's a big motivation for Cyborg to want to go defeat Steppenwolf and stop them from the invasion and everything. You know, saving the planet, you know. And that's why he was the heart of the film. But they completely, Josh Whedon, Jeff Johns, Diane Nelson, Kevin Susiar, John Berg, all these other snakes, and whatever you want to call these, executives like, no. It's too dark, blah, blah, blah. It's dumb. Zack Snyder had a plan, and they just completely trashed it because they just wanted to brighten it up. There was a cut military subplot from Justice League. This is pretty evident in one of the very first trailers. After watching Man of Steel and Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, one of the biggest changes to Zack Snyder's approach is that there's no larger media, government, or military present, and it turns out that there was a significant military subplot removed. According to actor Sam Benjamin, who is credited in IMDb as military policeman number 2, says he shot an entire 20-minute military subplot, including scenes with the villains and an action scene. And why did they cut it out? I don't know, because it's too dark. I mean, I can't make any excuse for these stuff anymore. It's just, they just cut it out. Partly because of the 2-hour mandate, partly because they were just trying to brighten everything up, and they just... Warner Bros. Doesn't know what they're doing. Jeff Johns is a hack, and he just tried to put this movie in his own term because he wanted to be the next Kevin Feige Marvel person or whatever, but he failed, obviously. The Justice League vs. Superman battle looked a lot different. The scene where Superman fights the Justice League in Heroes Park was significantly altered in a number of small ways. While the overall concept of the fight was largely the same, a lot of the dialogue was reshot. The military, who would have also been attacked by Superman, was removed, and the scene was significantly brightened to take place at day instead of night. Oh, they have to shoot it in day because we need more color, we need more brightness, because it's too dark. We're all gonna go cry to our mommies if it's too dark. The resolution to the battle was also changed, with Alfred rushing in with Lois, the big guns. Former Jimmy Olsen actor Mark McClure was confirmed he was supposed to be a police officer that acted as Lois Lane's chauffeur throughout most of the film, and we know that the trailers that he was already on the scene much earlier, as there's literally a shot of Cyborg saving him from a flaming Humvee. It's possible, if not likely, that Lois played a role in Superman coming to his senses, but it didn't happen as it portrayed in the theatrical cut because of the hack named Jeff Johns and Joss Whedon. Because I don't know. It's too dark. Superman's black suit made an appearance. This pisses me off because I really wanted to see the black suit. Even if he didn't wear it or not, I mean, I wanted to see it in the movie. When Superman famously returned from the line in the comics, he wore a black suit, so fans were curious if he'd wear something similar in Justice League, only to find it was entirely absent in the theatrical version of the movie. Nevertheless, one of the deleted scenes included in the movie's home release saw Kal-El return to the Kryptonian ship to recover his Superman suit, and a black version of the suit can be seen in the background. The black suit appears to simply be an Easter egg, but with so much of Superman's role reshot, it's possibly Snyder had bigger plans for the black suit before leaving the project. Superman's second first flight. One of the biggest fan favorite moments in Man of Steel was Superman's first flight after finding his suit on the scout ship, and he takes to the skies for the first time. While Superman is brought back from the dead in Justice League, fans felt like the movie was missing, among other things, obviously, a first flight 2.0. As it turns out, that exact scene was shot as confirmed by a Zack Snyder storyboard and would have taken place immediately after the deleted black scene, but ultimately wasn't in the movie because of... Why? Oh, we got it. I don't understand why this was an amazing and epic moment in the movie. It just That's why we need the Snyder Cut. Superman meets Alfred. Another deleted scene. Another released deleted scene bookends Superman's first flight and the black suit scene, and it contains Superman meeting Alfred. Part of the scene was included in marketing, so it was one of the many scenes glaringly missing in the final cut, and it depicted Alfred working on a car at Bruce Wayne's lakeside house when Superman arrives. After introductions, Alfred tells Superman he said you'd come. Now let's hope you're not too late. This line of dialogue obviously nods to an even more deleted content, but likely references Bruce telling Alfred that Superman would indeed return, indicating Superman is still a beacon of hope, at least for Batman. I don't know why they cut this out. This is literally less than a minute long. Like, it just... I mean, I guess they wanted to show, oh, wait, this doesn't have the CGI mouth. We can't have it in there. I don't know. It's just stupid. Like, just freaking stupid. Why would you cut this out? Like, this takes literally less than a second. Oh, it's going to be 121 minutes long, the movie. We can't have that. All right. Significant changes to the final battle. The film's third act was so aggressively changed that it's hard to detail every minor variation, but both story and visuals were impacted. The Russian family was entirely added by Whedon. I have no freaking clue why he added that. It was so dumb, so stupid. No one, like, they were there. Here's a plot hole because of this idiot. All right. So, parademons are supposed to see fear, smell fear, whatever. I'm 100% sure that Russian family was scared. Wouldn't all the parademons just go flying in at that Russian family because they're scared, because they smell fear? But, you know, didn't show it because, you know, these... Jeff Johns, Joss Whedon don't know what they're doing. When Snyder was asked about them on Vero, his reaction was, "What Russian family?" Because he didn't shoot it. He also confirmed that the apocalyptic root-like things that shoot out of the ground weren't his, simply responding to a fan, "Yeah, I don't know what that root stuff is." Yeah, because it was just some stupid, itty stuff that they wanted to brighten up the movie with, probably. The roots may have been just a small part of a larger visual divergence. Almost all concept art depicts a darker final act. Obviously, we wanted that with the strong H.G. Geiger influence, and early trailer shots from the scene have a blue nighttime appearance, while the final version is red with extra CGI roots to make it brighter. It hasn't been confirmed by Snyder whether or not the recolorization was something he was going to do as well, but it's definitely not what the movie looked like in his first trailer. I'm sorry, the person who wrote this article, as I said before, cannot write prop. I don't know. How did they not edit this stuff properly? But whatever. Superman was also significantly toned down for the third act. Frequent Zack Snyder collaborator and Justice League storyboard artist Jay Oliva said the original version of the third act would have been more unhinged version of the character, which would have been amazing to see. The defeat of Steppenwolf was also different. As was already mentioned, the original ending would have been more of a cliffhanger with the League seeing Darkseid, which would have been so badass to see and amazing. I don't understand why you would cut that out. Batman took over a giant parademon gun in the final battle. Batman's role in the Justice League is always a little funny because he's naturally nowhere near as powerful as the rest of the League. I don't understand how they do not write properly in this article. It's easy to write him as a tactician, strategist, and leader, but it's difficult in both movies and comics to find a way to make him relevant in big battles. In Batman v Superman's end battle against Doomsday, for example, he mostly keeps the shadows, only delivering occasional support, such as a precisely timed kryptonite gas grenade to Doomsday before Superman's killing blow. The same struggle is present in Justice League in the final act of the theatrical cut. Batman takes down the shield and distracts the parademons in the Batmobile, but once the vehicle is destroyed, he fades from relevance until after Steppenwolf is defeated, he gets a hold of a parademon rifle and can be seen using that to give support to the rest of the team. In Zack Snyder's original version, Batman gets a hold of a much bigger gun after ejecting from the Batmobile and assaulting the nuclear silo. There's a brief shot where an apocalyptic gun emplacement can be seen in the corner of the screen. Thanks to some concept art and confirmation from Zack Snyder himself, we know Batman was supposed to man that gun, surely making him a much bigger threat throughout the battle. Silas Stone gave the closing monologue, not Lois. The ending montage was also a few, with Also, a few notable changes. Since the original movie focused so much more on Cyborg, the ending montage was actually supposed to come from Silas Stone, not Lois Lane, after Cyborg discovers the video left for him by his father. Because Silas was supposed to be dead, that also means the moment of Cyborg forming his iconic chess piece was either absent entirely or played out differently. It probably played out differently. I don't know, like I said before, they changed up Cyborg's character arc. They crapped on his character and changed it up. This is just another result of that. Alright, post-credit scene. Lex Luthor's role in the movie was limited to a post-credit scene, but even after that moment, saw altercations by Joss Whedon. I can't stand his name. While most of it played out as Snyder shot, green screen footage of Jesse Eisenberg recording alternate dialogue can be seen in a behind-the-scenes video from Whedon's cinematographer, meaning the Legion of Doom was Legion of Doom tease at the end was not in the Snyder cut. See, I knew that, because the Legion of Doom just didn't seem like what Zack Snyder wanted. They were preparing for Darkseid, for more stuff to happen, probably leading up to the Batman movie, too. This whole thing, I don't get why, still to this day, why they changed up. Only thing I see is they were trying to lighten it up and doing all this and that. I don't understand the two-hour mandate. That was stupid. They were trying to fit in more times in the movie theater. I don't know why. You have Lord of the Rings, Return of the King, which is 3 hours and 20 minutes long. Made $1.1 billion back in 2003. And they made, not my point, they made $1.1 billion and 3 hours and 20 minutes. And you're worried, oh, we're not going to make that much money because we're not going to get enough shows in during the day. It's like, dude, use your head. You're stupid. It doesn't matter. People will go see the movie if it's good, okay? The movie's bad. And just because you mandated 2 hour times doesn't mean people are just still going to go watch it. This is frustrating just talk about, to see everything they changed from Zack Snyder's vision. He had a plan. Hopefully we'll get to see that plan. But anyway, guys, remember to keep the movement going. Hashtag release the Snyder Cut. That's why we need this. We need to see what happened. We need to see Darkseid. We need to see Apocalypse. We need to see all these characters, their stories played out. But anyway, guys, that's the video. Let me know your thoughts down below with whatever you want to say, if you agree with me or not, or whatever you want to say. Give me a thumbs up. Most importantly, hit that subscribe button and join my channel, and make sure you hit the bell for notifications. And until next time, guys, be amazing.